Raplat, an event for the ages. This annual softball game slash Red Solo Cup convention is one of the defining events of the Carlton experience. Whether one chooses to spend a day sipping bad beer, dancing in the mud, or making futile attempts at being productive, Raplat has touched us all. But this sacred event was not always this way. In this film, we meet the characters behind the founding of Raplat, explore its changes throughout history, and examine its place in the traditions of Carlton. It couldn't have been the Mickey Mantle League. It couldn't have been the Roger Maris League. It had to be Marv Raplat. Marvin Raplat was a Major League Baseball player from 1948 to 1951. Standing only 5 feet 6 inches, Raplat's career was as short as he was. After pitching only 35 games in the big leagues, Raplat was out of baseball by age 29 and soon started his new career as an insurance agent. But an uninspiring baseball life would soon blossom into a wonderful legacy. So Carlton already had its own intramural softball league, the Continental League. But they hadn't been accepting any new members for several years, and my friends and I were sick and tired of that, so we made our own league. So we had decided to make this league, and all we had to do was come up with a name. So Berg pulls out his baseball card collection, and there it is, Marv Raplat. Now we've got the Marvin Raplat Memorial Softball League. We started with only 4 teams, and let me tell you, that first year was a struggle. So, it's the day of the first game, and we realized that we don't have any softballs. So, I ran down to the store really quick and asked them if they had any softballs, and they said they didn't have any. But what they did have was grapefruits. Did you know that grapefruits are the strongest type of fruit? I sure didn't. Yes, we played the first game with grapefruits. Made some pretty good juice afterwards, too. Of course, the next day we did finally locate some softballs, but we had a pretty limited budget, so we could only buy one of them. So we played with this one ball the rest of the year, and it became somewhat legendary among the people in the league. We nicknamed it the tomato because that's what its texture resembled after a few times getting hit by a bat. Late in the season, I hit a ball straight into the ground, and when it hit the ground, the skin just fell right off the ball, so just the cork center rolled right to the pitcher, and of course he threw me out. Now, we had to get a replacement cantaloupe for the rest of the game. I think the only fans we had the whole year were Bob Leonard's girlfriends. Luckily for us, there were plenty of those.
But even after such an up-and-down inaugural campaign, the league grew and grew until it contained 10 teams in 1966. After he learned that Marvin Raplat himself lived near minutes from his Chicago home, Bob Greenberg contacted him and asked him if he would like to participate in a sort of all-star game.
I'm still amazed he didn't take it the wrong way. But Marv was almost too perfect to be true. So the day he was coming in, me and PT drove up to the airport in our car to go grab Marv from the airport. And as we were coming back down to Northfield, we decided we needed to give him the tour of town. So we went to the number one tourist attraction we could think of at the time in Northfield, which was the Malto Meal Factory. So we get in and we enjoy our cinnamon toasters and marshmallow mateys, and we go back out. Marv is having a great time. And we get back to the car and I realize that my key won't fit in the lock. And so we spent a minute or two kind of puzzling over this. I tried out a couple other keys, nothing was working. And all of a sudden, this old lady shows up out of nowhere and takes a swing at Marv with her cane. And she's really angry. She's just yelling and swinging her cane around and trying to whack people with it. And eventually, we calmed her down, realized that this was her car, and we were just trying to find our car. We told her that we were St. Olaf students, and we got back to campus safe and sound. I think Marv was pretty impressed. The All-Star game, and Marv was just hamming it up the whole time. After the game, we head on over to Old Goodhue Dining Hall and had a banquet with about half of the students on campus and President Nason in attendance. And at the end of the dinner, Marv gets up and is going to give his banquet speech. And he starts off with about 3 in a row incredibly dirty baseball jokes. And all the students in attendance are just looking straight at President Nason, who was looking straight down into his food. And it was just an absolutely priceless experience for most of us. We love the jokes.
It had been a perfect day for the Raplat Memorial League. The next year was the first without the original founders. It was 1967, and it was Carlton's centennial celebration. New Commissioner Ken Mortensen knew that Raplat should join in on the festivities.
We had already done the centennial drunk, 100 straight hours under the influence. A bunch of guys had tried to do the centennial panty raid, which was largely unsuccessful. And there was also a centennial human pyramid, which was unsuccessful because of gravity. So we knew that we had to come up with something big and something that would work. So we came up with the centennial softball game.
With a final score of 100-82, the Sots beat the Dirty Old Men in the game that would become the version of Raplat we know today. But how did such a prosperous league devolve into a drunken game? An examination of the league's stats keepers is quite illustrative.
When I was in Rapla, statistics were the lifeblood of the game. We kept everything. Batting average, home runs, slugging percentage, RBIs, fielding independent pitching stats, WAR, VORP, WOBA, Sierra, ultimate zone rating. You name it, we kept it. We were pretty ahead of the curve. Yeah, by the 80s, we were only doing the one game per year, so for stats, we just counted up a score on our fingers. Hey, can you time me? ¿15 seconds? That's a statistic.
But what was the root cause of Rotblat's shift in attitude? It turns out, as always, that the answer is scandal.
Yes, the Last Supper scandal. By the 1970s, Rotblat the League and Rotblat the 100-inning game had begun to be organized by two completely different groups. By 1975, these groups had entered into a bit of a disagreement. No one is sure about the exact genesis of this quarrel, but we can be sure that both sides were clearly enraged. In order to play a prank on the league organizers, the game organizers decided to distribute t-shirts at league events. These t-shirts depicted the Last Supper as a wild drinking event at a softball game, with Jesus Christ performing a keg stand while rounding third base. The college administration, wary of the college's new reputation as an atheist haven, was quick to shut down such lewd debauchery. The fire department quickly subsumed the Intramural Softball League and stripped it of its Rotblat name. Rotblat the Game was soon the only Rotblat event left at Carlton.
And so, Rotblat became what it is today. Although one can only wonder about what might have happened if not for the Last Supper, it is important to remember all of the great moments. The original founding, the All-Star Game, Marv Rotblat's dinner speech, copious amounts of alcoholic beverages. The spirit of the original Rotblat lives on in today's event. We can only hope that it will continue to do just that.